honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened worshippers Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 107, on stress and restlessness and agitation, and what to do with it, with a squint of Buddhist history. As you see, today we are out at the seaside, made possible by very silent, almost blank water, with no wind. Very fitting for the subject of absence of stress and restlessness. Thank you for your advantageous attention.
Friends, the seven links to awakening lead to enlightenment. A not very well known Bhikkhu once asked the best Buddha, "Whenever, sir, the seven links to awakening, the seven links to awakening, it is always said, in what way are they called links to awakening?" The Buddha then replied, "They lead to enlightenment, friend. It is therefore they indeed are called links to awakening. Here, Bhikkhu, when one trains, cultivates, and refines the awareness linked to awakening, sati sambhayanga, the investigation linked to awakening, dhammavichaya sambhayanga, the energy linked to awakening, virya sambhayanga, the joy linked to awakening, piti sambhayanga, the tranquility linked to awakening, prasadi sambhayanga, the concentration linked to awakening, samadhi sambhayanga, the equanimity linked to awakening, upekkha sambhayanga, based upon seclusion, disillusion and ceasing, maturing and culminating in release, then these seven links to awakening becomes noble and liberating. They lead anyone who trains them all out. They lead to utter revulsion, to intense disgust, to dispassion, to cessation of craving and greed, to peace, to direct knowledge, to complete destruction of suffering. They lead to enlightenment, to nibbana. What are the causes of knowledge and vision? The prince named Fearless once asked the blessed Buddha, "Venerable sir, what are the conditioning causes of knowledge and vision?" The Buddha then answered, "Here, prince, the bhikkhu systematically develops 1. The awareness linked to awakening, 2. The investigation of states linked to awakening, 3. The energy linked to awakening, 4. Joy linked to awakening, 5. The tranquility linked to awakening, 6. The concentration linked to awakening, and 7. The equanimity linked to awakening. While based upon seclusion, disillusion, ceasing, and maturing in release, when his mind is enhanced and enforced by these seven links to awakening, then he knows and sees all phenomena just as they really are. This is indeed, therefore, a cause for knowledge and vision. It is in this very way that knowledge and vision are caused by these ultimately specific conditions." The prince then asked, "What is this Dhamma explanation called, Venerable sir?" "These unique mental states are called the links to awakening, prince." "Surely, they are links to awakening, blessed one. Surely, they are links to awakening, fortunate one. If anyone who possesses even a single link to awakening would know and see things as they really are, what then to say of one who possesses all these seven links to awakening? How are the seven links leading to awakening? Venerable Sariputta once explained, they conduce and lead to the state of enlightenment. In this sense are the links to awakening. They are in and of themselves enlightening. Also in this sense are they indeed links to awakening. Establishing a meaning of awareness has to be directly experienced. Examination as a meaning of investigation has to be directly experienced. Exertion of effort as a meaning of energy has to be directly experienced. Intense contentment as a meaning of joy has to be directly experienced. Stilled peace as a meaning of tranquility has to be directly experienced. Non-distraction as a meaning of concentration has to be directly experienced. Even balance as a meaning of equanimity has to be directly experienced. They are enlightening as a root. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as a cause. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as a requisite. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as a purification. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as blamelessness. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as withdrawal, exit. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as delivering freedom. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as lack of fermentation. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as silent, solitary, seclusion. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as a releasing, relinquishment. Thus are they links to awakening. The Connected Discourses of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, Book 646, on the links, and in the path of discrimination, the Paticca Sambitta Magga. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 107. A good number. Due to the completely tranquilized surface of the water and absence of stirring wind, this Dhamma on Air, very suitable, directed towards the stilling or tranquilization of restlessness and stress, very common factor today, is by the seaside. We stepped out of the forest for one time's sake. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. There is three questions, and the first one is about this restlessness. How does one deal with excess of energy? Yeah, excess of energy comes under restlessness, udacha, which again is related to stress and also sometimes related to worries and regret, udacha kukucha, which is one of the five mental hindrances. Restlessness and regret.
It is the opposite of laziness and lethargy, tinamitta. So, how to deal with restlessness and the related state of stress of the mind? A Brahmin priest, he once asks the Blessed Buddha the following question. Master Gotama, what is the cause of being unable to remember something that has been memorized over a long period, and also that which has not been memorized? And then the Gotama Buddha answered 2,500 years ago. Brahmin, when the mind is agitated by restlessness and regret, stressed, stirred, troubled, and tyrannized by restlessness and regret, one does neither know nor understand any actual safe escape from this dominating restlessness and regret. In that very moment, then one can neither see nor ever understand what is advantageous, kusala, neither for oneself nor for others, and much less both for oneself and for others. Then consequently, even texts that have been memorized long ago cannot be remembered. Why is this blind neglect so? Imagine a bowl of water with the surface stirred up by wind into ripples, undulations, and small wavelets. If a man with good eyesight were to inspect the reflection of his own face in it, then he would neither see nor recognize it as it really is. So too, Brahmin, when the mind is distracted by restlessness and regret, excited, anxious, distressed, worried, perturbed, and upset by restlessness and regret, on any such occasion, even texts long memorized do not recur to the mind. Not to speak of even those text events, situations, or conditions that have not been memorized at all. So, the restless mind, he says, is like waves. It's the opposite state of this that you see here on the small Bremsnes V water surface, which is almost completely blank, a silver lake. This just corresponds to the tranquil mind. There you can't see the reflection of the forest, huh? It's duplicated across the horizon. And it stands actually quite sharp down there. Huh? Little less so over here. It is because of absence of wind, which will correspond to the distractions coming into the mind. New objects, the mind being bombarded constantly by objects. Visual objects, mental objects, thoughts, memories, sounds, all kinds of reminders of things, that it distracts it from the calm and tranquility that is its natural state. If you don't affect the water with wind, then it's still. If you don't affect the water with objects and distractions, then it's naturally still. And how to prevent this restlessness and regret? Yeah, there's frequent, often, and systematic attention both to mental and bodily tranquility like this. At the very moment one registers, observe, become aware of, become mindful of this restlessness in this mind, then one repeat this verbal device. There's calm of the body, and there's calm of the mind. There's calm of the body, there's calm of the mind. There's calm of the body, and there's calm of the mind. Just this discrimination between bodily calm, which has something to do with the frame here, not moving, not breathing hard, not having a high pulse, bodily tranquility. And then another aspect, which is mental tranquility, Just this notion, paying attention, rational, frequent, often systematic attention to this fact. Then tranquility sets in right there. So noticing restlessness and regret, being aware of it, can make it fade away by itself, by applying this verbal device. There is calm of the body and calm of the mind. He said, the Buddha, when restlessness and regret is present, the bhikkhu notes and understands, there is restlessness and regret in me now. While when restlessness and regret is absent, then he notes and understands, no restlessness and regret is in me now. He also understands well how restlessness and regret arise. He understands how to leave behind any arising restlessness and regret, and he understands how left restlessness and regret will not arise ever again. It's Majjhima Nikaya number 10. So let's look at the cause first. How does it arise? What is the feeding cause that make restlessness aggress arise? Yes, the Buddha said there are these states at various places that are unrest, unsettled, nervous unease, agitation and anxiety. The moment one gives irrational, because it's not sound, it's not good, it's not advantageous, an unwise attention to these states, unease, restlessness, worried, agitation, giving them attention is the feeding cause of restlessness and regret, and the feeding cause of worsening any restlessness and regret that has arisen. Typically like it, oh, I'm so stressed, I cannot find a way to do this or do that, or what I should do tomorrow, or I can never fulfill my task, I'm so restless and so stressed and I cannot do anything. So this make it become even worse, and it become habitual pattern of the mind. Because any attention to any state increases the probability that this state will recur, come back in the future. Due to habituation, it becomes a habit, in this case a bad habit. So giving unwise, frequent and irrational attention to restlessness and like regret itself, unease, feeling troubled, this make it arise, this make it grow. What is the starving cause that make restlessness and regret cease then? Yeah, there is a mental state of serene tranquility, calm, quietude, stillness, imperturbability, peace, frequently giving rational and wise attention to this exquisite mental state of ease and peace. This is the starving cause for the non-arising of absence, of already absent restlessness and regret, and reducing any restlessness that is already there. So it's giving frequent and wise and advantageous attention to peace and ease, stillness, just like there is here in a relative sense. It is this that make restlessness and regret cease on the very spot. A notion of a variant of this is just this verbal device we just have repeated. There's calm of the body and there's calm of the mind. So there one gives attention to calm, to tranquility. And this makes the mind tranquil. Some advantageous reflections when restlessness and regret is provoked. That is, when the mind is restless, then it's a proper time to cultivating tranquility, concentration, and equanimity. Upekka, prasadi, and samadhi. So these three links to awakening. Tranquility, prasadi, concentration, samadhi, and equanimity, upekkha, these should be trained in this state. Not so much energy, avidya, that would just stir up the mind. Restlessness and regret, actually, the Buddha he likened to a form of slavery, where the mind is slave of itself. It likes to do something, but it cannot point out what to do because it's distracted. So it tries to do something all the time, but cannot do it because it doesn't know what to do. And it always flickers and shifts to something else. So he likened to slavery. It's slave of itself. While the opposite state, laziness, he likened to a prison because there the mind is closed in. It cannot do anything because it's kind of like locked up in itself. And I think any restlessness and regret, any stress, it's very easy to see that it's a form of slavery. Not a slavery that is enforced from outside, but a slavery that bubbles over from inside by the mind not being able to see it. That is a self-induced, self-imposed slavery. Just as when a man is a slave, not independent, but dependent on others, unable to go where he likes, exactly and even so is restlessness, since it forces one into unwanted, unneeded activity and destroy any ease of calm. Later, when one is set free from slavery and is now independent, no longer dependent, a free man who can go wherever he wants, at that release one rejoices and is genuinely glad at heart. That is, as soon as restlessness leaves the mind and tranquility sets in, then joy appears, gladness. And this sadness of constantly being stressed, constantly agitated, constantly being pushed by something that seems to be dominating one from outside, but actually is something that comes from inside. Deliberately directing to a conscious and clever center of concentration, herein Ananda, a bhikkhu attends to this single and sole focus. This is real, this is supreme, namely the stilling of all mental construction, the calming of all restless activity, the fading away of all concern and anxiety, the cooling of all temptation and urge, the ending of all longing and craving, the exhaustion of all fuel of becoming, this ceasing, this peace, this bliss, this freedom is Nibbana. It's from the Anguttara Nikaya, number 5, Book of Fives, Sutta 319. So, actually, the extreme of restlessness and regret, now you see the stirring of the water, the mirror image is gone, partially here and almost fully there. You cannot see the image there, what is actually there in this reflection. And so also in the reflected mind, in the stirred up mind, there one cannot see what is advantageous for oneself, for others, nor for both oneself and others. It's impossible when the mind is stirred up like this. There's two tools on restlessness and regret on whatbuddhasaid.net. I'll give the links down here and under the video. Again, the trick is, one, to notice that this is present in mind. There's restlessness and regret in this mind. It's stirred up. It's not calm. And then apply this verbal device, silently repeating in inside one's head, oneself. There's calm of the body. There's calm of the mind. There's calm of the body. And there's calm of the mind. There's calm of the body. And there's calm of the mind. Then already there, any restlessness, any agitation, any anxiety, any unease of overdue excess of activity is calmed down. is tranquilized. As you see, now the mirror image appears again when the wind goes away. So much for this question. Question 331. In the Nikāyas, the Buddha said that the Dhamma would last 1,000 years if nuns were not ordained, but yet only 500 years if none were to ordain. Why does the ordination of Buddhist nuns, Bhikkhunis, half the life of the sasana? It's true that he said that. Actually, that's what Ananda had to ask him 3 times. On the request of his foster mother. The Buddhist mother died after 7 days. All Buddhist mother dies after 7 days. And then her sister, that also had a small boy, she took over the upbringing of Buddha Gautama. And she later wants to become a nun and ask him twice on 2 different occasions. And Ananda interspersed also. But the Buddha twice were reluctant to give permission to for nuns to ordain. And at the 3rd time, he gave the permission. I have to say up front, I don't know why it is so that the Buddha say that the normal length of the sasana would be 1,000 years, but if nuns were ordained, it were only 500 years. I don't know. There's many who have hypothesized about it, but nobody had come up with a good explanation. But actually, he gave permission to nuns to be ordained, as all the other Buddhas before him have given allowance for nuns to be ordained us also. So both male and female can walk the noble way in a monastic setting. There's 2 reasons. Now, actually, the sasana, the dispensation, has lasted 2,500 years, and it will last 2,500 years more. 5,000 years. And why is that? The explanation for that comes from the commentaries. The first one is that the Buddha set down 8 rules for nuns they should abide by and in their relation to monks. And these 8 rules is half of it, why the tradition will lasted longer than he expected at that time. And the other thing, and he couldn't know that, the Buddhists can know only what can be known, but that's just not part of all. They cannot know something that is not determined at the point of time where they make the prediction. So at that time it was not determined, because this was first determined after his death, that Mahakasapa would meet a recluse that had a divine flower in his hand, and he would recognize this divine flower and ask him where he had this flower from. And then the recluse will tell him that his master, Mahakasapa's master, the Buddha, just has died and was in a nearby city. And right at that moment, a old man that has just come into the Sangha, he said that he was happy about the Buddha dying, because the Buddha let so many rules of what they should do and not do. And this was also not determined that he would say that at that particular event when the Buddha died or before the Buddha died. And therefore, these 2 circumstances, unknown at the before the Buddha died, they made the Mahakasapa, Venerable Mahakasapa, the father of the Sangha, decide on the very spot that they had to make the first council 3 months after the Buddha's death, where they used 7 months in a Satapatthani cave. You can see it here in Rajagaha. It's still a place of pilgrimage. I hope to visit one myself. To hold the first council, where they recited and put down a formalized version of what the Buddha said, which we have read up here several times, which is basically the Tripitaka, the 3 baskets of text, the Vinaya, the monastic rules, the Sutta Pitaka, which is the prose text, and the Abhidhamma Tripitaka, which is kind of like the signs or the matrix formulation of the Dhamma. And it's because of that putting down this in a formalized, frozen text collection of roughly, I think there will be something like 7,000 or 8,000 pages, maybe more. It's not translated yet fully. It's 56 volumes in the PTS Roman edition, probably 2 meters of text. So he taught for 40 years, so there's a lot of material to read and also to understand.
Because of that, the sasana have now lasted 2,500 years and will last 2,500 more years. They said that the first 500 years, arahants will analytical knowledge, patita sambhita makkha, they will be present. The next 500 years, arahants with dry insight, non-meditators, will be possible. The next 500 years, only anagamis will be possible. This is the present age now. It's from 1517 to 2517. Only anagamis will be possible. And from 2517 to 3517, only sakadagamis, once returners, will be possible. And the last 500 years will, from 3517 to 4517, only Sotapanna's stream entrance will be possible. But this is all material from the commentaries, and there's disagreement about it. We don't know. Another tradition, the Burmese tradition, says that the first 2,500 years, the five stages go through these 2,500 years. And then the next five, then another period where arahants are possible, and five periods again where all the four nobles, in this case five nobles, types of nobles, they are possible. This is we are in the second round. So there is disagreement. The Buddha never made any notion about how the sasana will disappear and how long time it will take. But in general, one can say what this first going away is attainments of the jhanas and of nobility. And then the analytical knowledge goes away. Then the text starts to degrade. And he said that this first starts to degrade is the presence of the Digha Nikāya, and the last thing that disappears is the Jātakas, the birth stories. So we are living in a very fortunate age where there has been four Buddhas, and the sasana of the last fourth Buddha, Gautama, still is present and still have almost 2,500 years run time. So now it's time to make an effort. There will come one more Buddha. After this, the period, sasana will disappear. After it will disappear, when the relics, among this, the two relics in Kandy and other relics, they are not respected, then they will collect in Bodh Gaya, at the place of the Bodhi tree and the Bodhi mandala, exactly where the Buddha were enlightened. There will be no humans present, but devas will assemble there in great numbers. And then this effigy that is made out of the refuge, this effigy that will come out of the relics, because it was decided that the Buddha, before he died, that this will be so, it will promulgate the Dhamma, the complete Dhamma, one more time to the devas, but not to the humans. And then they will burn up, and this will be the formal end of this sasana, the burn up of the relics. So they will also perform, this effigy will also perform the Yamaga miracle, the twin miracle, where the Buddha effigy will rise up in the air, and then there will come water and fire out from the lower body and from the higher body at the same time, alternating. This is a twin miracle, famous twin miracle. And then they afterwards, after having given the Dhamma in full to the devas, then they will burn up without reminder. And this will be the formal end of the sasana, of the dispensation. Lastly, there's this question about what is question 332. On full moon poya days, that's 12 of those on a normal year, lay Buddhists observe 8 precepts, not only 5 as on other days, but 3 precepts more. And the question goes like this, what can one who's observing the 8 precepts consume after 12 p.m.? Because one is not allowed to eat on these observance days after 12 p.m., just like monks are not. Cheese, malted milk, coffee, or energy drinks. Yeah, milk products is, strangely enough, both for monks and also for lay people on observance days, regarded as solid food. So one is not allowed to eat solid food after 12. So this cannot be partaken of. Anything that is mixed up with milk, that is malted milk, cacao, and so on. But energy drinks, tea, coffee, juice, and even soup without solids, they can be partaken of if drunk and not used, eaten with a spoon. So anything fluid that not contained solids, small pieces of whatever food, solid food, and is blended, completely blended, this can be partaken of, but not milk products. I hope this answered the question. What are the 8 precepts on full moon opposed to days that one observe in brief? Then there are first the 5 normal. Not to kill, 1. 2. Not to steal, 3. Not to engage in sexual intercourse, including a masturbation in this case. Not to speak lies. Not to take intoxicants, here or under, any kind of illegal intoxicant, any kind of alcohol. And then the 3 extras. Not to eat food between noon and the following dawn. And dawn is defined as when you can see these edges in your hand, then it's allowed to, you're allowed to eat. That is at dawn, not at sunrise. It is usually between 5 and 6 in most cases. So one goes out, stretches the arm out, and if one can see these stripes, then one is allowed to eat, without artificial light, of course. Not to sing, dance, watch entertainments, nor to use ornaments, cosmetics, or perfumes. That's the 7th. This means television, you can see Dhamma and so on, read Dhamma on the computer, but something like TV shows, teledramas, and such things, football games, cricket games, they cannot be seen on this day. Similar with music. Not to sit or lie on a large bed or high seat. Best to sleep on the floor, but anything that is lower than one's normal bed will do okay. And not to use kind of like embroidered coverlets and pillows and so on. Simple sleeping on these full moon nights, observance days. Actually, there's 2 of them. There's new moon and full moon. So there's 2 every month. But usually they are only kept at full moon. But that's a regression from the original advice of the Buddha. One should keep it observance day, both at new moon and at full moon. And there is, and I will give the link below here, a calendar on whatbuddhasaid.net that shows every observance day throughout 2018, and there will also be a new one in 2019. So many were the words this time. So please remember to subscribe to this channel by clicking subscribe on the small link. Rotate your mobile phone horizontally, then you can see the little click the small red sign, or go to the channel and then click the subscribe button. Click also the bell on the other side down here if you already have subscribed, and click the like button if you like. Thank you for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thank you also to all the donors, especially the regular donors, which keeps the wheel turning and these videos being produced every week. Now, the water is slowly calming down over here. And we see the mirror image again, standing not fully clear yet, but it's coming, and so is also here. There's calm of the body, and there's calm of the mind. That's how to still any restlessness and stress, giving frequent, unwise, and therefore irrational attention to this stressed state. This is the opposite way. That is the way to make it grow, arise. There's calm of the body, and there's calm of the mind. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the Blessed Buddha, indeed. And may you and all beings in this infinite cosmos have a nice, calm, and peaceful day. Thank you. There's calm of the body, and there's calm of the mind.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pampalela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha.
Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.
There is calm of the body and calm of the mind. Calm of the body and calm of the mind. There is indeed calm of the body and calm of the mind. Both leads to peace, ease, and gladness. Thank you.